Hi, Dr. Savitri. Welcome
Hi.
to this wonderful session of Equitable Healthcare Access Consortium. This is a small initiative of EHAC during the Women's Week that's going to come from 8th to 11th of March, wherein we are inviting speakers, women speakers, who are contributing in healthcare space and with their initiatives, with their efforts, they're trying to make healthcare more accessible, affordable, available, and thus equitable for everyone, which is the theme of EHAC. So we are very honored and delighted to have you with us today. And I'm super excited to speak to you, having read about your, when you're working in rural healthcare space, as soon as you have passed out your MBBS. So I'm looking forward to a wonderful discussion with you. So let's start.
Yeah.
So Dr. Savitri, as you told us that you just finished your MBBS last year. Yeah. So before we talk about your journey as a medicine, we would like to know more about you. So I'd like to know about you, about your family. You're from Tamil Nadu, as we know. And particularly we are very keen to know about your family environment when you grew up with respect to education for girls. So over to you.
Yeah. So I'm actually from Kerala, but my parents have been working in Tamil Nadu even before I was born. So I was raised there. So both my parents, they work with Bhabha Atomic Research Center, which has a center around 70 kilometers south of Chennai. It's like this, it's a township, but it's set in a rural area and it's on the coast of the Bay of Bengal. So it's a really quiet, beautiful place. So that's where I grew up. And within the township, the Department of Atomic Energy has their own schools, they have their own hospitals. So even though it was cut off from the main city and it was quite a rural area, but we had all facilities nearby. So both my parents work in BARC. So as such, being a girl child, it was never a hurdle for me to get access to education or even in any of the other opportunities that I was offered during the course of my education. And if we talk about my childhood, it was a pretty good, happy childhood, so to say. Okay. There were a lot of books. I was always, I loved reading fiction and novels. So, and we had some really good friends around, and then it was mostly a very happy-go-lucky kind of childhood. Since I was not in a big city and there are not many schools, the kind of competition that we hear about, that was not always there. It was pretty chill that way, and we had very informal, the friendships were pretty honest, and it was a very innocent childhood in many senses.
And that's why we have you where you are, contributing to the community, close to, like where you grew up. You say you grew up by the countryside, enjoying the natural surroundings.
Yes.
So moving forward, I'm particularly interested, Dr. Savitri. So you did your MBBS from MGIMS Wardha, which itself is a center of excellence and pioneer institute in the country, and it's known for its community engagement and community service. It has all the Mahatma Gandhi's principles they abide by. So my question to you would be, what made you choose medicine as a career, and in particular pursue your medicine from MGIMS Wardha? Was that a conscious decision to choose Wardha to do MBBS?
My choice of medicine was, it was not like, I was not one of those children who from childhood wanted to be a doctor. I had various ambitions all through, like every class I would be interested in a new subject and I would say, this is what I want to do. So I was pretty confused that way, I could say. But my parents are the ones who actually told me that if you can do it, then it's a really worthwhile profession to go into. So you should definitely try. So then they encouraged me to go get the entrance coaching and all that. So I this college was not really well known back where I was, where I come from. So I learned about it through one of my teachers in the coaching institute, and then we applied for the exam. So one thing was that, yes, I was always when I decided to become a doctor, of course, my idea was that it should be, we should serve people, and the status or the money was never an attraction that way. But the choice of the college was deliberate. It was my fundamental reason for that was that the other college that I had gotten was very close to home. It was in the very, very similar surroundings. So my mother, especially, she felt that, no, I should go out, stay in settings that are very different. Only then would I explore my own personality and also the world around me. So Sevagram was ideal in that sense because it is also a similarly rural setting. When we visited the place, we really liked it. And the prospectus and also the surroundings clearly spoke of its Gandhian influence. And my parents were very happy that this would be a very good place to, you know, safely leave you and go back because it's nearly 1,000 kilometers from my home. So, and going around there, even I liked it very much. So that's how I reached there. I did have a lot of interest in Gandhi, but it'd be too cliche if I say that it was Gandhi that took me there. I cannot honestly say that that's what happened.
But probably the destiny had its plans to put you at the right place, I would say.
Yes, absolutely. And, the choice of being in a college has been a huge, it has a huge impact on my life. Had I studied in another college, I would not be what I'm doing today. I would not be doing what I'm doing today.
Okay. So can we say that studying in MGIMIS did shape your thoughts about your, like you said, you chose medicine, and then when you chose medicine, it was in your mind, okay, you should be serving the community. So probably what I am able to, you know, grasp from what you said is that studying in MGIMIS Wardha gave you the necessary reinforcement or the boost to your thoughts to maybe pick up, you know, or sail in the direction that you wanted to. It kind of kept you rooted to the community, and then because in MGIMIS you also, you know, get to go into remote villages and meet those you know, rural communities there, understand the gaps in the healthcare systems that exist. So can we say that MGIMIS Wardha had it did impact your thinking in a large way as to what you should be doing after your MBBS?
Yes, it very much did. In fact, not just MGIMIS as a surrounding had a huge impact, because before that, my idea of so-called health delivery was, say, free clinics, or, you know, this very messiah kind of an image about the poor, and then you're going and serving them, whatever. But once I reached there, and then when, especially during these village visits and all, you start to demystify this poverty, and it becomes like, okay, you know these people, you connect to their lives personally. Not as a, like, okay, I'm a service provider, I'm coming and I'm giving you this and I'm leaving. The Santa Claus approach just disappears. There is an orientation camp that MGIMIS does right at the beginning of your curriculum, where you're supposed to stay in the ashram for 15 days. So during that program, we had several speakers who had come and spoke about different topics to us. Most of them were Gandhian. They believed in the Gandhian ideology. So one important person was this Dr. Ullas Jaju, who is also head of Department of Medicine in MGIMIS. So he spoke of this session. It's a very famous story about this child who dies of diarrhea in a village. It's a story it starts from when the child has its first episode up to the reaching the hospital late, and then because of the lack of roads and so many issues. Basically talks about the access to healthcare issue. So then he ultimately asks us what killed the child. So dehydration is just one thing. Like, you realize that entire systemic issues are responsible for what happened to that child. And that session, in the very first year, even before we learned anatomy, physiology, it changed the, to me, it had a huge impact. The way I looked at health, the way I looked at why people fall ill, how people fall ill, that changed quite a lot. So that had a huge impact. And there is one other very significant thing, that is that in MGIMIS, I was very lucky to be around several people who not as part of the curriculum, other than that, Wardha is a place where a lot of socially active people meet. And I used to feel like we're very privileged in that sense, because we sit in Wardha and very great people come to us, and then we get to meet them. If you go to Bapakuti on any random day, you're very likely to run into some really good person who has been working, doing some incredible work in some part of the country. So So that way I've met several very interesting people, and they have had a huge impact on me. And one other thing is Nirman. I don't know if you've heard about it. It's a youth development program run by SURGE, Society for Education, Action and Research into Community Health. Akash Bang sir's uncle, Abhay Bang.
Okay.
Runs this program. It is in Gadchiroli in Maharashtra. So okay. I was a part of that program from my third year. So that was also very instrumental in, you know, kind of rooting these things and kind of making me sure that, okay, this is what I want to do.
Okay. So that's interesting. And that's why, you know, where you call, you call institute as alma mater. So that, I would say that is, that has proven, it's like truest sense in your case.
Yes.
Moving forward in our discussion, Dr. Savitri, so, you know, you grew up in Tamil Nadu and now you're working in Chhattisgarh, Balur.
Yeah.
And I just looked at the distance is quite, the distance is around 1600 or so kilometers, one end of the country to another. So any particular reason, what motivated you to go into Balod, Chhattisgarh and start working there and especially pick up primary rural healthcare as, the path forward in your career?
So, so when it comes to Balod, especially when I was in third year, I had visited this place where I'm currently working in. This as part of this meeting of this group called Medico Friend Circle. So it's a very loose group of pro people health professionals all over the country. So they had their meeting here and then I had attended it. So at that time, they spoke about how Shaheed came about and its history. And so that I was a third year student and I was like, okay, it was really incredible for me to hear that. There were a group of laborers who, after completing their, say, 8-hour, 9-hour work in a mine, they would come back and then they would construct a building to make it a hospital for their own health needs. So the whole concept of communities empowering themselves enough to, you know, take care of their own health. So this was one very classical example of it, in the context of course, a political movement also, but still. So then we also met these group of 2-3 doctors who have been with the movement right from its beginning and who continue to work here. So it was a very incredible moment for us because I had several young friends who were all in the question of where to work, where to, you know, they were looking for this place that, okay, where this would be my people and then they would settle there and work for those people. So then I saw these doctors who had stayed here for 40, 45 years in spite of so many hurdles in between. So, and then Shaheed as a hospital, it has a huge, it serves a very huge population and it's a very reliable center for many people here. So a huge range of illnesses, I mean, patients come with a lot of illnesses. So from the clinical perspective also, it's very, it has a rich experience to offer to any doctor. And the best thing about Shaheed is also that even though you're a junior doctor, you are given responsibility. The management trusts you enough to kind of handle your responsibility and say, okay, you can manage this case. Yeah, so the exposure is also very good and also the trust of the management, which ultimately makes you become a more responsible, more competent doctor. So all these reasons I saw at that time and I was like, okay, I would really like to work here. That's how I decided in third year. Then, of course, it was a dream at that time and we did not know how things would turn out. So then after MBBS, since everything else worked out, so I decided, okay, I'm going to come here for a year. Of course, it got delayed by 2-3 months nearly because of the COVID pandemic. I just went home after my internship and the lockdown came. And so I could not come out for another 3 months. But yeah.
Oh, so do your family support your decision initially? They did not say that, okay, why didn't you come back to your hometown? There is a lot to be done here as well. So what was their reaction to your decision of going to Chhattisgarh all the way? It's a new territory for you, for them.
That is exactly what they said, what you said. They were like, I mean, they overall they said okay, it's a very good thing you're thinking, vagara vagara. But then when it comes to practically,
it's ideal.
Yeah, they were like, no, no, are you really sure you want to go there? It's like the exact thing that you said. Ki yahan pe bhi to log hai, inko bhi to doctor ki zarurat hai, vagara vagara. That was there, and especially during the pandemic, it was really a struggle to kind of convince them that it will be safe and vagara. All that was there, but I was relentless, and ultimately they had to give in. So that was the thing.
And that's amazing. That's like, you know, when you have a goal in mind and you are so, you know, your conviction, your determination. And as you said, your parents are educated and they support you in all your decisions. So I'm sure they would have understood at some point of time that their daughter is actually on the right path. And she is going to touch a great number of lives through her contribution to the society. So, Dr. Savitri, how does a normal day for you looks like, you know, at Shaheed? And then what satisfies you most about your work?
Yeah, so a normal day is, it starts around 9:30. So we have our morning rounds. Like, I primarily look at general medicine. That is my favorite subject also. So we have morning rounds. And then after the morning rounds, there'll be some procedures to be done. Say, for example, Pleural tapping, something like that. After that, we go to the OPD. So either I go to the ANC OPD, which is like depending on whose duty it is. We have a kind of a rotation system, or otherwise to the general OPD. And after that, by 2:30, the OPD is over. Then we, on a normal day, we go again for the evening rounds at around 5:30. And then again, evening rounds, post rounds, we come back by say 9:30, and then we have dinner, and that's how it ends. Every 4 or 5 days, we get a one night emergency call. So then after this 9:30, from 10 o'clock, our emergency starts. It's up to 6 in the morning. Then we get to sleep from 6 to 2, and then again 2 to next night 10 o'clock, again we have emergency call. That's how it
very, goes. Very nostalgic for me, because I have also worked as a clinician, say, for 7 years or so of my career.
Okay.
And, ranging from tertiary care to missionary to corporate hospitals. So I know exactly, my days were also the way you are describing yours. So I'm just quite, you know, now eager to know if you have some wonderful example or a story to tell us, our audience, about, you know, because you are dealing with the communities directly, your impact is so direct. Any work which you think which is exactly the gratification, the reason why you are there, matlab, you know, when you treated somebody, and you know, because of your presence, the person, whether it's counseling or the person improved, and that gives you, you know, that keeps you boosted to be there to continue your service. If you have some wonderful example or story to share.
Yes, there are many actually. Especially during the COVID peak, we also had our malaria and scrub typhus peak going on simultaneously. So these are much worse killers here, because they don't get diagnosed. Malaria gets diagnosed, but scrub and leptospirosis, they don't get diagnosed as easily. So we had this very young girl who had come with her saturation was 34%. And she was like, she was extremely breathless, and she had here the one problem is that the way these people perceive their illness is very different. So we don't get like a textbook history that, okay, this day I had fever, the next day I had this symptom. That never happens. They come to you when they have some really bad symptom, or they stop eating. These are the two reasons why they would come to you. And then they would say something like, weakness, then everything has to be a negative history. Or sometimes you don't get any history, and then it's just the physical examination that tells you what happened. So in this girl's case, the same thing happened. They were not giving any history. They said, we went to a hospital, he gave IV fluids, and then this girl collapsed and started having breathlessness. So it was basically a case of heart failure, but it was because her kidneys had failed and she had scrub types. So this magic drug that is doxycycline, I call it a magic drug because we have seen it do wonders here. So we started her on the drug, and in 3-4 days she was well, and we discharged her before time because she had an exam to go to at home. And so she, from the jaws of death, she really got back to like complete life in 3 or 4 days. And that was extremely satisfying. And even today when I lose a patient, I remember her and I say, okay, you lose someone, but you save someone else. And, you know, it's a bargain.
So that's the spirit, is, yeah?
Yeah.
Because, you know, rural healthcare is, I mean, there's so much to do. The factors that impact rural healthcare are, I would say, much different than the factors that impact urban healthcare. The social determinants have a big role to play in rural setup. The lack of, and then I would say the rampant, you know, I would say whether it's misuse of antibiotics and the presence of informal providers around and people's trust in informal providers, which is so difficult to, you know, so difficult to motivate them to pursue the right path, to trust the right person. I have myself been in that space and realized that the change does come, but you have to, you know, be there, you know, you have to stay perseverant and just keep nudging. Only then your efforts over time would give you little result. So,
so like we had this patient who fought with us because she wanted to discharge the next day because she had an appointment with this Bayaga, which is basically a Mantravadi kind of jhadu puk doctor.
I know.
So she had an appointment with him to, what is that? They are going to sacrifice a chicken. And she was like, I have this appointment since 1 month, I must go. This woman was in heart failure and we were telling her to stay for 3-4 days more. But she was like, no, I have to go. And then her relatives fought with us. And she was like, it is an emergency. I have to go and sacrifice a chicken. We were like, okay. We only could be amused and said, okay, ek point ke aage, you cannot restrain
them. No, you cannot. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely. Sometimes you have to, in order for you to listen to one thing of yours, you have to listen to many things of them.
Yeah, absolutely.
So that's, moving forward, Dr. Savitri, so I am now curious to know about your plans, you know, for future. Do you intend to do post-graduation? You've just said general medicine is your favorite subject. Yeah. If you intend to do post-graduation, where do you see yourself as a post-graduate doctor, doing what, in what space? So tell us something about your plans.
Yeah, so I do want to do a post-graduation. If I could, I probably would not do it, but I guess legal and so many other requirements, it's safer to have done it. We had quite a lot of discussions about whether to do a post-graduation or not also in many spaces because our friend circle frequently talks about these kind of issues. So currently I have decided that yes, after completing my 1 year here, I'll go and I would be doing, I would be preparing for the NEET PG. And my dilemma is whether to take general medicine, which is a specialty, or family medicine, which is more suited for a setting like this, if wherever I would like to work eventually. So that is one dilemma I'm still yet to kind of solve in my head. But so I would be pursuing either of these. Again, general medicine is very difficult to get in the PG entrance. So that is going to be a big determinant, of course. After that, I don't have very specific plans that, okay, this is where I'm going to work or something like that. But even if I'm doing post-graduation, I would very much like it if it's a setting which is, which doesn't look down upon, like, or it is not considered cliche if you really go out of your way to help a patient. Then, where it is okay to be doing that, then people would still be like, okay, it's fine. Because I know several places where if you go out of your way, it would be considered like a funny thing or something that people would kind of ridicule and say, okay, ye sab karne ki kya zarurat.
It's just about the culture and values of the organization, Some organizations have this thing as a part of their culture and values. Where if you don't do this, you would be considered as, okay, you don't, our thoughts don't align with yours.
Yes,
so, that's, you know, you had those values to begin with initially and you landed with MGIMS Vardha. And now you have chosen Balod. So I'm sure going forward, there are wonderful organizations in the country enthusiasts.
You have to explore actually, travel also.
Yeah. So Dr. Savitri, because it's we are talking about women at work in healthcare. My one question to you would be about if you have you ever faced challenges at work, especially being a woman? And if so, how did you overcome them?
So as a woman, I would not call them challenges. Like even this space where I'm working in, because it was started by such revolutionary people, in the workspace, I don't face that kind of challenges. But yes, I have seen that there are, like, currently among the clinicians, I'm the only girl. We do have an 80-year-old gynecologist doctor who's working here. She's quite elderly. I'm talking about these young lads. So I see that in such spaces, many times it's not easy for us to come as girls and then work here, like, especially owing to your parents' fears and these kind of issues. So, but personally, I would not say those are challenges I face. But I see most of the, in Shaheed at least, it is a nurse-run hospital. Like the backbone of this place is the nurses, because doctors have always been short and people like me, we come for a year and we leave. So nurses are the one who run the entire setup. And so when Arnaz told me about this thing, so I was like, that I could give you a list of people who you should speak to, because we have such incredible female role models here. And for me, I come from a privileged background, and it's not so much of a challenge for me. But then the people here, that they are doing such incredible job coming from such difficult settings. So they are really people that, so I think that, okay, I can't even, sometimes I feel I can't even claim the female identity, because I have not faced any of those challenges that these people face. And especially the nurses here, many of them have, even though they are nurses, they are personally quite educated and everything. But then their families, because the system is very patriarchal, their families are not very supportive of many of the things that they do. Especially the husbands. Many of them deal with alcoholic spouses, domestic violence issues, so many things like that. But in spite of that, the kind of commitment they bring to their work is really incredible. And especially the fervor they show to educate the children, kind of, you know, empower them. That is also very, very incredible. And standing within these spaces, they still bring about empathy. They bring innovation into their work. So which I think is really exemplary. And, on seeing that, I feel, okay, there's a lot more that many people can do.
Yeah, that's true. You know, until I had spoken to you, I didn't know about Shaheed Hospital. I didn't know about its history. It's so amazing. You know, we come back from work, we say, oh, we are tired. And you look at these laborers, they are mining. It's an absolute physical labor.
Yes.
They mine, they go so deep down. They mine for 8 to 9 hours and they come back and then they do something else as well. So look at their motivation and stamina and, how headstrong they have been. So I think when you see more such people, when you hear these stories, you know, you get more boost, you know, you get more power to pursue your passion. So
also the current Dr. Saibal Jana is the current director of Shaheed. He's been here right from the time of its foundation. So his wife, she's not a doctor. Her name is Alpana Jana, but she's a nurse. And then she has had a very instrumental role in training and bringing up this nurse workforce, which is currently holding the hospital, you know, stable. So, Dr. Jana has been imprisoned twice or thrice. So during those times, madam has looked after the entire hospital. And she is a very strong woman who has a very direct role in this health setup, which is currently benefiting a lot of people. So these kind of women, they exist in, like, many of these organizations that we know today, they have such very strong female backbones on, you know, foundations who are basically responsible for what the organization is today. So that is a very incredible thing to see.
So inspiring. I think we are at the end of our interview, Dr. Savitri. And in the end, I would just want you to, you know, I would rather request you to, I solicit, I would say, your advice for our young doctors in making, because we know there is something called rural-urban healthcare divide.
Yes.
And this, who better than you can know the rural healthcare, urban healthcare divide, because you are there looking at the gaps in the Indian healthcare service delivery in rural setup, the social factors that impact the health outcomes. And on the other hand, we are also aware of the tertiary care hospitals in the thriving in the urban landscape. So what advice would you like to give the young doctors in making?
Okay. I don't know if I am qualified to give an advice, so to say, but like I can just go along my own experience. What I would say is that in the rural areas, work is a lot more satisfying because the impact you make is very visible and it's huge. It's like you can really place yourself and say, okay, I made, not as an like as a personal
Absolutely.
Credit,
I
but like this
you,
person
yeah.
is responsible for this person, for this family going from here to there. So because the need is that huge, your small presence can make a huge impact.
Absolutely.
So the personal satisfaction is very high. Then of course, the perks of living in a rural area, the rural India is a very beautiful place. The people are very innocent, they're very welcoming. So all these huge, hue and cry about violence against doctors, mistrust between doctors and patients, all these things are relatively very little here because the doctor-patient relationship is still very innocent here. They still trust you. And as long as you don't exploit the trust, it is going to be there. It's a very loving relationship between the doctors and patients. So as a person, I feel to a young doctor, I would say as a person, you get a lot of peace, you get a lot of self-growth here. And the social impact is definitely there. But as a person, it leads you towards a more holistic life as such. So the reason I'm saying this is because many times if we go in the direction of like, okay, there is a problem and I want to solve it, that is definitely a very excellent, very good approach to have. But if you're not able to see as a person how it's going to benefit you, along the route somewhere, we may question our choices or we may regret it. If you're not sure that as a person, why is it that I made this choice? So I feel that any person aspiring to go rural, urban, wherever, they should primarily connect with them, kind of realize that why would they want to make that choice? And what are the benefits of making this choice or not this choice? So in that sense, I feel a rural setup gives you a more holistic approach towards life, even as a person. And of course, as a health professional, the impact is beyond words. So that's
yeah, thank you. Thank you for your wonderful words. One key takeaway from this session for me is that when you made that beautiful statement saying that your small presence can make a big impact, that's exactly... You know, you have summed up the entire, the intent. This is exactly what rural healthcare community service is about. Because even if you have few families around you, you're just being just one person, you are just directly connected. You can really, you are working at the grassroots level. You can see the impact you're being able to create. So wonderful, lovely, lovely speaking to you, Dr. Savitri. We really, really need such passionate and doctors like you to come forward and just drive the healthcare system for this country. And we
Thank
look
you,
forward
Dr.
to speaking with you again. Thank you so
yeah,
much,
sure.
Dr. Savitri.
Thank you.
Thanks. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Bye-bye. Have a good day.
You too.